you been avoiding conflict lately? Are you afraid that if you speak your truth to someone, you might damage the relationship permanently? Is inner conflict eating you up inside? Maybe you're thinking one thing, but doing another, and you just can't seem to get your head and heart to line up. As humans, we all deal with conflict. Join Jennifer McKenna now as she talks to business leaders about the importance of conflict and how we can all move through it with greater grace and ease, ultimately taking our relationships and our lives to the next level by facing conflict courageously.
Welcome to Conflict Rising, everyone. We have a guest, Scott Nichols, to talk to us today about the future of food. I know we've talked a lot on this show about food and multiple angles of it, but when you think about it, culturally, where are we if we're not feeding ourselves adequately? And so it's a big topic, and we keep covering it in multiple ways. And today, I have to say that this angle particularly gives me a lot of inner conflict and angst because my 15-year-old daughter pointed out an article today about the rainforest and deforestation and how farmers have actually set it on fire intentionally to try to create more space to grow. I guess to start the cattle farms, I'm not even sure, to try to meet the demand of the food supply, the demand of the consumers. And so I'm botching all this up. I'm not articulating it well. That's why we have Scott on the show to straighten us all out on the facts of what's really happening, why we need to be thinking far more seriously about the future of our food and what we can all do about the threat to it and how to think innovatively. So, Scott Nichols, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much for having me. I'm really delighted to be here, Jeanette.
Well, we're very delighted to have you. Scott is the founder and CEO of an organization called Food's Future. And so we want to hear all about this expert on this issue. So, Scott, why don't you just start, kick off the conversation by telling us, why did you start this? What is this company about, Food's Future, and why did you start it?
I've always been interested in food. And also my own professional interests through time have been about what do we need to do to find ways to put ourselves on a pathway that leads us to ever greater environmental stewardship. And so I had been an agricultural researcher for a long time, and then that led to about a little over 12 years ago becoming a salmon farmer in southern Chile. And after having done that for about a decade, I left that work to advise people on how to accelerate the expansion of responsible aquaculture. Because I think that aquaculture is one of the most promising things in our food future from both an environmental perspective, a food quantity perspective, and a nutrition perspective. So for me, it was the confluence of many things coming together that led me to be where I am right now. A lot of it was professional practice, and a lot of it was personal and professional interest.
Well, so I did not start a company like you did off of this premise, I have to say that you're touching on exactly why I have so much inner conflict. I am very highly in tune with what my body needs to be healthy. I have a very large perspective around wellness, right? I'm not the typical consumer that just says, I'm just going to drive my body into the ground and then go to the doctor to fix it. And the only reason why I'm not that typical consumer is because I lived that in my early adulthood and lived to pay a very high price at the expense of my health. So that's the only reason why today I am as healthy as I am, because I learned the hard way. But with my hypersensitivity and vigilance toward this, I have to say that it is very difficult to make decisions on a daily basis about what I'm going to eat when I consider the larger macro view of what my food choices, how they negatively may impact the environment, and then on a micro level of, but I need to make good food choices for my specific body. And I think that we have a growing number of people who have that conundrum inside themselves as they decide their meals and as they do their grocery shopping. So mm-hmm. I'm just really jumping right in, but we have all of this. The population is continuing to grow. Access to information can, you know, makes us hypersensitive to different food allergies, different sensitivities, different types of proteins. I mean, it runs the gamut. There's so much information. So when you have this background and you were working with in an aquaculture, how did you pivot from that to this much larger scope of, oh my gosh, we really need to be thinking about the future of our food? And can you tell me why you're passionate about that bigger macro topic and what you're trying to do with your company?
Okay, I wrote as fast as I could, and I think I have all 19 of your questions on my page. So, with respect to aspects of environmental stewardship that you mentioned, I think it's important to say that all agriculture has impacts on the environment. And if you look at any farm, and then you look at the land that may be next to it that's unfarmed, there's a big difference. So when you drive through the Midwest, you don't see necessarily tall prairie grasses everywhere. You see a lot of corn and soybeans. When you drive up and down the California coast, you don't necessarily see the scrub oak and grasslands. You see arugula farms. The interesting thing about, or an interesting thing about aquaculture or raising food in the ocean versus raising food on the land, and I think it's the sort of thing that gives one pause, is that in the ocean, one raises food in the environment. And on land, one replaces the environment and then grows food. And that means that there are lots of differences in the way that farmers need to behave and the responsibilities that are put on them and the ways that they respond. So you can't fertilize the ocean. You can't do the sorts of remediation that you can do with agricultural land. So you can fertilize, you can add nutrients in various ways when you farm on the land, but you can't do that in the ocean. So that makes aquaculture from an environmental perspective different. And one of the things I think that is really important to think about in the way in our food supply is we need both calories and nutrition. And those often don't come from the same sources. So, for instance, on the land from an acre of field corn, you would get about 15.5 million calories. From potatoes, 15 million calories. From spinach, you'd get 1.7. And from eggplant, you'd get 2.8. So, on the land, the way that we raise our food, we're obligately separating nutrition and calories. One of the interesting things about aquaculture is that we can get both from the same place. So we can get both, for instance, from the salmon farm. We get both calories and nutrition. That's another thing that makes aquaculture unique in the way that we raise food. And another thing that you mentioned is what do we do about changing populations and changing demographics? Mm-hmm. Right now, our current agricultural practice uses about 38% of the world's land and 70% of the world's fresh water. And we're expected to go from a population of about 7.3, 7.4 billion where we are right now to a population of 9 billion in probably about the early 2040s. But not only is our population increasing, which gives us a need for more food, but demographics are changing too. So right now, there are about 1.5 billion people on the planet who are in what you could loosely call a middle class, and that'll increase to 2.5 billion in a decade and 3.5 billion in a decade after that. And with changing income and changing available disposable income comes a change in what people want to see on their dinner plates. And so a variety of organizations, the FAO and then academics as well, have said that we need somewhere between 1.5 and 2 times the food in the early 2040s that we have right now. So Given that we're already using 38% of the world's land, we're not using the worst 38%, we're using the best 38%. And you can't plow up every median strip in the United States to plant something on it. So the one thing we know about the path to a hopeful food future, a plentiful one, is that it's not the path that we're currently on. And that's where I think that aquaculture steps in that it's able to provide an awful lot of food for us. There's a person named Hallie Frelick, who's a professor of environmental sciences at University of California, Santa Barbara. And she did an exhaustive study of the world's oceans, where she looked at things like, the question in front of her, or that she posed, was, on what portion of the world's oceans can we grow food? And so she looked at places where the depths, for instance, were accessible given our current technology. She excluded sensitive environmental areas. She took out areas that were under oxygenated, and a variety of things. By the time she had excluded the areas that wouldn't serve as very good places to raise fish, she found that it was about 3% of the world's ocean surface. And when you kind of think about what that means, what she did was to do a further calculation and to say that the entire world's production of fish, that's aquaculture and wild fish, right now, if it were grown in an intensive farm type of environment, would occupy an area about the size of Lake Michigan. Put in perspective with the 3% that she had said is available for us to farm, Lake Michigan would comprise 0.015%. So if, for instance, we were to farm not on 3% of the ocean's surface, we were to farm on, say, 6 times that 0.015, just 0.9% of the ocean's surface, and then working through a variety of calculations and assumptions that I'll go into if you want me to, but I won't if you don't, what we find is that that productivity would be able to provide 60 kilograms of fish per person when we are 9 billion people in the early 2040s. So that's an astounding amount of food that could be provided to us if we are to find ways to farm in the oceans and to do so responsibly. So that gives me a tremendous amount of hope for what our future could be. We still have to build our future, and we need to learn from the mistakes that were made in terrestrial agriculture and certainly at least not repeat those mistakes. If we're going to make our mistakes, we ought to make them new, creative, different ones, but not the old ones that were already made. And if we do that, then I think we have access to a food supply that's provides us both calories and nutrition. So I'll stop there. I think I answered some of your questions. I don't think I answered most of them.
Yes, and you also, inspire other questions because I think that when the average person like myself hears any conversation around the ocean, aquaculture, fishing, we immediately go into the thoughts about how the oceanic environment is being very heavily threatened right now because of the practices. So, we've got one conversation over here about straws. We have another conversation going over here about just plastic in general. And then I went to a conference a couple years ago, an international affairs conference that focused on the oceanic environment. And, they were just showing story after story about how these fisheries are just blatantly abusing the ocean and the fish, and the practices are just astonishingly horrible. So I don't know, what do we do with all that? So we're going to take a quick commercial break. I've thrown out a big, large question, hypothetically. Maybe in the next, when we come back from the commercial, Scott, you can help us break that down so we can get far more comfortable about aquaculture. So stay tuned.
Connecting you with the best of the conscious minds in the world. OMTimes Radio. IOM FM.
OMTimes Magazine is one of the leading online content providers of positivity, wellness, and personal empowerment. A philanthropic organization, their net proceeds are funneled to support worldwide charity initiatives via Humanity Healing International. Through their commitment to creating community and providing conscious content, they aspire to uplift humanity on a global scale. Connect at OMTimes.com. OMTimes, creating a more conscious lifestyle.
I'm Kathy Williams, host of Sexy Mom Abundant Life radio show on Thursdays at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Pacific. On the show, we explore living abundantly in every area of your life. Ways to let go of limiting patterns and beliefs and to step into the flow of creativity and possibility, knowing you are supported by the universe.
Opiates has taken everything and everyone I've ever loved away from me. Everything.
I blew my ankle out and I got prescribed pain pills by my doctor.
If making my detox public is going to help somebody, I'm all for it. I just wish I would have had a warning.
Opioid dependence can happen after just 5 days. Know the truth, spread the truth. A message from Truth, the Ad Council, and ONDCP.
Welcome back, everyone. We're talking to Scott Nichols with Food Future, and we're talking about the future of food. Sorry, I'm tripping over my tongue today. So, Scott, I don't know that I asked you a direct question before we went to the commercial break, so let me back up and clarify. We as consumers get a whole lot of information, conflicting information about the oceanic environment. So when you talk about promoting increase of aquaculture as a means to feed a rapidly growing population, it may make some people a little twitchy. We might think, wait, aren't we depleting the ocean already? Aren't we abusing it? How do we responsibly go do that? Can you answer some of those concerns?
Okay, let me start with, you had mentioned fisheries. And so let me speak first to fisheries. The Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations undertakes a biennial assessment of both fisheries and aquaculture. And in 2006, when they looked at the fisheries around the world, they ranked them in three ways. Underutilized, utilized at capacity, or overutilized. And in 2006, they found that 75% of the world's fisheries were harvested either at or above their sustainable limits. And in 2016, when they did their study, they found that it was about 91% of the world's fisheries harvested at or above their sustainable limits. So when you look at something that's harvested above its sustainable limit, and this is a really simple thing to deal with, you just stop it. Yeah, there's no big question that you have to answer with that. When you look at something that's underutilized, you say, okay, we're fine with what's there. But it's this group that's harvested at their sustainable limit. And what do you do about that? And I would say, if I can make a very rough analogy, if you're driving your car and you drive it right at the tachometer limit between red and black, and you drive your car there all the time, you leave yourself no room for any kind of safety for the engine of your car, and you should probably drive at lower RPMs. I think the same sort of thinking applies to world fisheries. We can't just always harvest them at their exact sustainable limit and hope that we're going to be able to have them in the future, because there will be something like a weather event, climate event, that will push that fishery over the edge and make it a completely unsustainable fishery. What that means is that we probably should be getting less of our fish from wild fisheries. Now, with respect to aquaculture, again, as I said before, any kind of agriculture has effects on the environment. Everything does. And so the question is not whether something has an effect on the environment, it's what effect does it have on the environment and what do you do to mitigate those effects? And I would say with respect to aquaculture, it's the most scrutinized sector within agriculture. You don't see people standing at the grocery store looking at the tomatoes, pulling a card up out of their wallet or pulling some app up on their phone and saying, are these tomatoes red, green, or yellow ranked? They just don't do it. And that kind of scrutiny doesn't exist for what's grown on land. Likewise, people don't do that generally when they're standing in front of a chicken or a piece of beef. That is the state of the world for fish, though. And there are organizations that look at the practice of fish farming and try to offer guidance with sets of standards for how that's done. So in particular, one is the Aquaculture Stewardship Council has developed sets of standards for responsible farming for a number of species. And then assessors will go to farms, if the farms wish to be assessed against the ASC standards, to determine whether those farms meet those criteria and whether they can be certified. I should offer a disclaimer here. I'm a member of the board of directors for the Aquaculture Stewardship Council, so I'm not without a dog in the hunt here. There are also
thank you for that.
I do believe I wouldn't be part of the organization if I didn't think the standards were exemplary. But nonetheless, I do believe it. but also Seafood Watch, which is a part of the Monterey Bay Aquarium in California, has standards, and they will also assess farms and then also assess regions for the way that they're farmed. So the two organizations behave differently in the way that they approach farming. But there are people who are out there doing that. And so there are very responsible actors in raising seafood. There are irresponsible farmers raising seafood as well. And I don't think that that's all that particularly different than what we find in terrestrial agriculture. So about a little over a decade ago, there was a case in Colorado where farmers were raising melons that they knew were tainted with bacteria, and people became sick, and in fact, some died. And when that was finally taken to its fruition in a federal district court in Colorado, those farmers were put on trial for their activities, which were criminal activities, and they were actually convicted. So the question is then, how do we find responsibly raised seafood? And there are not only are the organizations there that do certifications, there are grocers that do assessments of the seafood. And they are many. So in the area of the United States where I live, which is just outside of Philadelphia, should I just say a market, J-Mac, or can I mention names? We didn't talk about this in advance.
You are welcome to listen. The way I look at it is, if a company is being responsible and we want to let people know about them, okay, then we absolutely mention them by name.
All right. So Wegmans is just a completely responsible organization. They have people who go out and they look at their farms. They meet their farmers. In certain cases, they do something that is really, from a business practices point of view, not the best practice in the world, and that they will single source fish from a farmer or a farming company. And so usually in any kind of supply chain, what a business wants to do is they want to diversify. So if there's a problem somewhere with one supplier's ability to provide them, slack can be taken up by others. So anyway, I would say, and they're not alone in doing that. Costco is one that does that just as well, and Whole Foods. So these grocers are out there doing their best to find fish that they can bring into their stores that's responsibly raised, and they have places on their websites where you can find out what their practices, what their standards are for how they bring seafood into their markets.
You've mentioned several organizations, those that kind of, pardon the expression, police practices, and then you have others that actually the grocers who are responsibly choosing what we as consumers can come and purchase. So is there a place or any of the organizations, maybe one that you're on the board of, is there a website somewhere if a consumer would really like to know and would like to go to support or purchase, I should say, is there a place where they can go and just get a list? Who's doing this the most responsibly?
Yeah, you can, at the Aquaculture Stewardship Council website, you can go into the search engine and you can actually find places where you can find the names of farmers and see how their farms were assessed. And I believe you can find out where their fish are sold. The same is true at, at Fishwise, I think, is a site that you can go to. if I can talk and scan at the same time, I'll see if I can find their website. and then the individual grocers will have things there as well. So there are many. NOAA has not sales recommendations, but NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, they have a great deal of discussion about fish in aquaculture at their site. So that's a place you can go to get information as well.
Okay, very good. Okay, so I am hearing that you're saying when we look at the broader landscape of where we're headed with the growing population and the nutritional and caloric needs, you're just a huge proponent of aquaculture, responsible.
I am.
Aquaculture.
I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
With anything, I mean, again, so it's fishchoice.com. And if you go there, see, I can talk and scan my computer at the same time. You can go there and you'll find individual recommendations of species, grocers, and all on their site.
Okay.
I am a proponent of responsible aquaculture because, again, I believe we can't get to where we need to go with terrestrial agriculture. So I think in the example that I gave, where 38% of the world's land is used in our current agricultural production, I think one thing that comes out of that that oftentimes doesn't necessarily occur to people is we really have to intensify our agriculture. And that's a thought I don't think that really comes into people's minds when they think about our future food supply. But we need more from what we've got. And so the sort of the mantra for the agriculture of the future is do more, use less. And this is one area where I think aquaculture fares, again, pretty well in that the resources that are required to raise fish are generally quite a bit lower than the resources that are required to raise terrestrial animals. And so, for instance, it takes about 2 pounds of food to raise a pound of harvested salmon, so the fillet that's actually in the case. And it's about 21 or 23 pounds of feed that are required to raise a pound of beef that ends up on your plate. Beef is interesting because it's raised in a variety of different ways. And some of it is raised on pasture land, but in the United States, most of it is raised in more intense agricultural settings. So
okay.
From a resource utilization point of view, again, aquaculture fares very well. And when you think about it, it makes a fairly good amount of good sense in that fish don't have to develop a skeletal system that helps them contend with gravity. They're in a weightless environment, so they don't need big, thick bones to stand up, whereas land animals do. And then the second thing is fish don't need to maintain their body temperature. So they don't use calories to heat their bodies, whereas mammals, of course, do. And so the combination of those things is that we eat far more of a fish than we do a terrestrial animal in general, and it takes a lesser amount of resource input to get a set amount of fish.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, you know, we're probably going to go to a commercial break here in just a minute or two. And when we do, I want to come back and I'm going to ask you some very granular questions about as we consumers shop for fish and so forth. But before we go to the commercial break, my biggest question at this macro conversation level is, what about, you know, we think about the world's population growing so incredibly quickly, and what about those areas that are so landlocked and how much resource it takes just to get seafood, you know, delivered to these areas that are already struggling? Have you thought about that challenge in your proposition that aquaculture is the answer?
In a word, or in two words, not much.
Okay.
So we have agricultural distribution systems around the world that really do move food through great distances, and those are developed to different extents in different countries. There are, though, opportunities to grow fish in inland systems. So tilapia, for instance, is being grown on farms that are not in the ocean in Africa, as well as in Indonesia. And so there is some availability of fish within areas that are more landlocked. There was a really interesting program that was put together by an organization called World Fish about a decade or so ago. What they did was they made grants to build farms in villages in Africa, and the first proceeds from those farms were for the villages themselves. And then as those operations grew, they expanded and became marketplace players and would sell fish into other markets. And then the proceeds that the profits that came from that were used to develop AIDS clinics in the villages where the farms were. And this is work that was done by a guy named Stephen Hall when he was the CEO of World Fish. And there's a case where fish farming can play a role both in food production and in larger communities.
Okay. Very good. Thank you for that. Okay, stay tuned, everyone. We'll be back to finish out our conversation about the future of food with Scott Nichols.
Free your mind with OMTimes Radio, IOM-FM. Host your show on IOM-FM, the radio network of OMTimes Media, one of the more recognized brand names in the conscious community, and is backed by the extensive marketing reach of OMTimes. Hosting a show on IOM-FM immediately connects you with our extensive, dedicated community.
Hello, I'm Sandy Sedgbeer, host of OMTimes Magazine's flagship radio show, What Is Going On? My passion is sifting through information, research, and innovations from new thought teachers, speakers, and researchers pushing back the boundaries of what we know about life, energy, metaphysics, and the universe. I love shifting perceptions about who we are, why we're here, and how quickly impossible becomes normal when we open our minds, expand our awareness, and accept that the only limits that exist are those we place upon ourselves. So if you're the kind of forward-thinking, eager investigator of what lies beyond the current reality that most perceive, why not make a date to come play with me in the field of possibilities at 4 p.m. Pacific Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time every Thursday, and together we can discover what's really going on.
Imagine being fired because of who you love. Imagine being denied medical treatment because of who you marry. Imagine being evicted because of who you are. Millions of Americans don't have to imagine this. They have to live it. because in 31 states, it's legal to discriminate against LGBT people. Get the facts at beyondido.org. Brought to you by the Gill Foundation and the Ad Council.
Welcome back, everyone. We will continue our conversation with Scott Nichols about the future of our food. And, you know, Scott, before we went to the commercial, I said, well, I would like to talk more when we come back about a fish, some fish questions from a consumer perspective and a consumption perspective. You know, basically that means, can we talk about what I eat every day? So I have a daughter who is very acutely aware of what's going on in the greater landscape when it comes to nutrition. She's got a very high interest in her consumption issues and the environment. So when you put it together, when she's hypervigilant about what she eats and she is hypersensitive to what's happening in the environment, I get inundated from a very worried teenager all the time with articles and information about all the problems out there. So I started the show opening up with the story that came out today about the Amazon being on fire because I received 3 texts from her within 5 minutes of my morning. So this is high on our minds. So we talk often about what should we buy to consume to get the protein that we need to sustain the amount of activity. We're both very active, and so we have thought, boy, it would be awesome to be vegan. We aspire to be vegan. We worship the people who are vegan. We just think they are so cool. We cannot do it. we have accepted that notion finally after trying multiple times. But honestly, when you see a story like today that comes out and says that the fires are so big in the Amazon that they saw them in space and that there's been an 80% increase in those fires, deforestation fires, by the way, from the one rainforest that is providing an exceptional amount of support to us as human beings on this planet as we continue to bastardize our environment. It's an ecosystem that we heavily rely on for our own health. So it does further, in my mind, support your notion that agriculture is, we're really consuming agriculturally at a level that is hurting us environmentally tremendously, it seems, and that keeps increasing, it looks like, according to today's headlines. Would you agree with that? Am I overstating it?
No, I don't think you're overstating it at all. It's just alarming in the extreme what's happening in the Amazon right now. The two crops that lead to the greatest amount of deforestation are beef cattle and soybeans. And that's happening to a very great extent in Brazil. And so there is a worldwide organization called the Round Table on Responsible Soy. And they actually offer certifications for the way soy is being raised around the world. And soy is one of the primary contributors to terrestrial animal diets. And I would also say it's a contributor to fish diets as well. The protein from soy is used in aquaculture fish farm feeds. So you're right to be concerned about that. 3 tweets in 5 minutes makes for a very long day. I hope that slowed down for you a little bit. But, I mean, your daughter's right to be concerned.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's amazing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so she's also, you know, she's 15, she's a female, she's developing, growing, body image, you know, is a concern, health and wellness and all these things, right? It should be important to us at all stages of life. But 15-year-old girl, it's heavy on their minds. So when we grocery shop, she does a lot of the cooking. She does, you know, meal planning. She does her and her brother's lunches every day. She just really likes being in the kitchen. She really likes food. She really likes learning more and more about it. So I think she will be tickled to death when I tell her that you're a proponent, that it's okay. We can eat fish all day long.
So can we break it down and say,
how do we do that responsibly, Scott? How do we consume fish responsibly and that we really understand how to find the win-win, the win for us and our health and the win for the ocean?
Well, the sources that I mentioned before are places that you can go to find a bunch of information. From a food perspective, and I hope we're going to have time to do at least a couple of recipes before we quit here, okay? This is, after all,
excellent.
It is about dinner. Okay, good.
Yeah.
So, but what I would say is that fish is a really fundamentally important part of our diets. And one of the, I think, the important things to know about fish is that fish is, as a whole food, isn't just the sum of its parts. So a fish isn't an amount of protein or an amount of omega-3 or an amount of selenium. It's all of this put together. And the effects of eating fish are better at promoting health and wellness than eating a diet that's made up of components. So I think that's one really important thing to note. And when we think about some of the things that we really can only get from fish that are really crucially important for our health, one of those things is the essential omega-3 fatty acids. Now, omega-3 fatty acids are a class of fatty acids, and there are many members in the class. And some of them, in brief, some of them are shorter. They're 18 carbons long, and some of them are longer. They're either 20 or 22 carbon atoms long. We humans are not at all adept at converting the 18 carbon omega-3s into the 20 and 22 carbon omega-3s, which are the ones that are so crucial for our health. And those come from marine environments. So they start actually with algae in the ocean and they work their way up the food chain. The omega-3 fatty acids that come from avocados or flaxseed or walnuts are used for calories, but they're not used as the essential structural components of our cells that the marine, the fish-based, omega-3 fatty acids are. So that is a really compelling reason to consider including fish in your diet and not necessarily relying on a vegan diet where you're going to be at a dearth for these. There are emerging supplies of plant-based or algal-based omega-3s that don't come from essential omega-3s that don't come from the ocean. So for vegans, there's help around the corner, but it's just not there right yet.
That is fascinating. And I'm going to have to actually go back and listen to the recording of this and take notes to really absorb all that you shared.
Well,
because we don't.
I will say that I've written about this a bit. If you go to my website, you don't have to listen to this again and take notes. So if you go to foodsfuture.org, there are some articles there that I've written about omega-3 fatty acids. And then there's also places where I've written elsewhere, and then there are links to those articles. It's not too hard. It's pretty easy to get to.
Yeah, I can remember when my children were very young, people would laugh at me because we would be in the grocery aisles, and, you know, my children were like 3 and 4, and so they were always going for the boxes that had the superheroes on them or the sparkles or, you know, whatever it was. And other shoppers would hear me say, okay, guys, so this is called marketing, and you are falling for what's called a marketing gimmick, and I want you to turn the box over, and I want you to read it to see if there's any food in there that you recognize. And that was how they, you know, basically that was one of their early stage learning reading lessons at home was in the grocery store. But point being, in most things, they didn't see like the word apple.
Right.
But what I'm saying is we do tend to, as consumers, fall for marketing gimmicks. If something says it has omega-3s, we just raise our eyebrows and say, yay, that sounds great, and put it in the shopping cart and move on. If we read an article that a certain food has something that we need, we just go out and buy it, right? And it actually gets a little bit more complex, as you were describing. And sometimes, honestly, it's just there's so much information that we just want to go peacefully, get what we're craving, and go home and eat it guilt-free.
So the best thing
so
is
that's
to crave
why I'm a big fan of
salmon.
Can we dumb this down for me?
Yes, there are things that you can get from fish that you can't easily get elsewhere.
Yeah.
So you go.
Yeah, and so I think what I'm hearing is there are also things where we don't even know the benefit, right? We're getting things that we didn't even know we needed. Is that right?
Yes. Most people aren't familiar with selenium. It's not something that sort of creeps into day-to-day conversations. And if selenium is something that comes up at a dinner party, you're running with the wrong crowd.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
So, but there's
I'll be on
more
the lookout for that.
Folks out there.
Okay, very good. So before we go, was there a recipe or something that you wanted to share? You did tease that out.
So I wanted to be able to share a recipe at least before we got off. And I was going through my file and I came on this one. It's salmon with cranberry sauce, and then in parenthesis it says, what I did when I found we had a salmon and just about nothing else in the house on a Sunday night.
So, there you go.
So,
so it's easy.
This is what I did. Toasted some pine nuts and ground them up, and then put in a couple of cups of frozen cranberries and ground them up with the pine nuts. And then I put a bunch of basil leaves in there and some horseradish, and then blended that. Then what I did was I stuck a salmon in the oven, skin side up, and I roasted it until the skin started to turn a color that pleased me. I flipped the salmon over and I spread the cranberry, basil, pine nut over the top. Oh, I also included honey in that. I should have said that. And then I kind of put that over the top and I put it back in the oven for another 8 or 9 minutes until the fish was cooked. So the whole time from finding out what in the world are we going to have for dinner, because we have a basil plant in the yard, we have frozen cranberries and pine nuts in the fridge, and a piece of salmon. That's it. It's all it took.
That's fantastic. And it's making me hungry, I have to say. I can't say I have any pine nuts in my cupboard, so I'm going to have to change that.
You don't have pine nuts in your cupboard?
Can you believe that? I know.
And you said this
I need
in
to change
public.
That.
Oh, my goodness.
I know. So I'm going to change that. I do need to go to the grocery store tonight. It will be added to my list, and I'm gonna make this. It sounds fantastic.
Well, you could use
so this
old
is something
right?
You just made up on the fly with what you had sitting around?
Yeah.
I would say you know, if the food the future thing doesn't work out, you might want to consider, you know, the chef route. Well, sounds like you're handy in the kitchen.
I'm handy in the kitchen, but I am just abysmally slow. And if I were a chef for anybody, I just don't think that would work. When all of my kids are over for dinner, what I'll hear is one of the kids will ask my wife, what time's dinner? And my wife will say, 7:30. And then the kids will say, who's cooking, you or Dad? And if she says, Dad, then the kids will say, get out the chips and stuff because it's a really long time till dinner.
That's great. Well, one thing we are grateful for is that you did start Food Future and that you are investigating all of these things and are able to then inform those of us who are both curious and conflicted. And I hope that those who are listening today are less conflicted because of what you have shared. So I do know that I will, yeah, I do know for myself, and I thank you for this, that I will feel much more peaceful as I shop for dinner tonight. So for those of you who didn't hear, go to foodfuture.org.
.org.
And check out more of Scott's writing and work. And until next week, take good care of yourself, and I'll see you then. Thanks again.